This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Welcome to the Hit Back. I'm your host, Nahaja Black. We got a good show for you today. Today is an interesting discussion that we'll be having, and we'll dive into it. I've got a guest, though, that's joining me at the top of the show. Really, for a quick segment, if you aren't aware, with all of this talk of a third wave, there are still other things that are going on. And first of all, I just want to say good afternoon to everyone. You are listening to the Hit Back with Nahaja Black, Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. If you notice my train of thought is, well, I'm not sticking the landing on my words today, but you'll get an idea of what's going on in this neck of the woods. Today, we're going to be talking about this third wave as well. Dr. Dwayne Sands will be joining you. My good friend C.A. Nuri will be co-hosting with me today because I think we need to just listen. We got to get real with the situation. The situation has gotten real with me. And so we have to now have real conversation. Not just we now. This was a conversation we were supposed to have. We were having months ago. And it is what it is today, but we will be discussing that. But before we get there, what this month is, I think we have also, I think this is April was Mental Health Month as well. And so I don't know if May is Autism Awareness Month. Is that what it is, Marsha? Is it this month? It's this month. Okay. I've got joining me a wonderful Bahamian, a wonderful human being. I've known her for quite a while. So it is what it is. And she has been a part of this wonderful organization that is very much needed by so many parents who are, you know, using this service. So we have Marsha Newball from REACH. And we are discussing Autism Awareness Month. Marsha, welcome.
Thank you. So nice to be here. Thank you for having us.
It's such a pleasure to have you on the show. I want you to quickly give us a sense of what is going on this month. Folks are quite aware. I think many Bahamians are aware of REACH and your REACH. But a breakdown for those who may not be that aware, because it's not in their world, it's not their purview. You understand? They're not directly affected. What is REACH? The acronym, what does it stand for, and what this month means?
Sure, thanks. Well, REACH stands for Resources and Education for Autism and Related Challenges. And it was established in 1999 by parents, teachers, caregivers who couldn't find resources for their children with autism. So now, all these years, and we've connected with many different organizations. Well, the United Nations has designated April 2nd as Autism Awareness Day, and we've stretched it to Autism Awareness Month. Mm. When it wasn't COVID, we had many activities and events throughout the month. We've had to downsize a bit this year, but we did have a drive-in just at the beginning of the month where parents were invited and friends of REACH to drive onto the campus where our office is located at Queens College. We had speakers. We had a parent of a child with autism. We had recognition for parents who have stuck through 13 years of raising their children, 16 years, 30 years on the autism spectrum. And they received accolades, awards, plaques for their work with the organization. Always bringing awareness, but now just asking everyone to see the person.
Right.
Not the label.
Yeah.
That's where we are today.
Has COVID-19 or all of the restrictions, how has it affected persons with autism? How has it affected families with, you know, of course, being locked down? Of course, revenue is a challenge, but the person, the individuals, those autistic children and adults, how has this been affecting them?
Well, picture you're of sound mind and strong, and then you lose your job. That's difficult. But picture when you're on the needier side of that, and all of a sudden everything is gone. It becomes very challenging, not only for the child, the parents, who have always been balancing if they have a job, because many have to stay home to take care of their children. So it's compounded. So I think we do have to do more for the children with special needs during events like this. We have to learn from this and not do it again.
I'm sure that's an understatement even, Marsha. Marsha Newball from Reach joining us. And I'm sure you're trying to be, you know, you can definitely say that there was an understatement, how you wanted to say it. It was nice. Because I figure that this has been a very, very difficult, right? Very difficult.
If you have two children at home with autism, you know you needed a lot of help.
Some folks have two children.
Yes. Yes. Oh. Of our members, yes.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's a lot. That's tough. So, okay, how does Reach has been doing what again, and how can we all be in support? I know one parent with an autistic child, and I know how much they fight for their daughter. And they're not, these are not wealthy people. These are people who are hustling every day, right? Exactly. So how can we be of assistance?
Well, just know that the majority of the parents are those who are not generally wealthy, because it just costs, even if you are, it costs so much, at least $30 to $50, $75, $30 if you're lucky, for therapies, because the best support for these families is therapy, speech therapy, occupational therapy, ABA, behavioral therapy, and all of these. Oh, if you find a therapist, they're generally booked out. Mm-hmm. And then the question is finance. So yeah, it was very struggling this year for us not to be able to do the things usually for our families. But we were able to have some, like, we didn't have the Easter egg hunt that we usually have. Our children don't usually get invited to parties either.
Yes, okay.
So we were limited with the Christmas party. We had to have a drive-by, and which was so nice, because we had Santa there giving out gifts to the children.
COVID-19 infections and increasing hospitalizations have placed the Bahamas in a dire situation. That's from former.
But we were able to hold some events, and we had to work within the confines.
COVID situation is under control.
COVID restrictions.
Sorry, you got to forgive me. Too much things going on my computer. All right, go ahead.
So we did have some events for our parents this year, and we did get great support from the community through, for example, Super Value, Rubis, other organizations that were giving generously so that we could support our families. And it was greatly appreciated by the organization and parents.
Yeah, I appreciate you so much. How do we... So then, okay, do we go online? How do we help fund you guys? Is there a space we can go to?
Well, we do have, we have our email, which is reachautismbahamas.com. reachautism@yahoo.com.
Got it.
And then our phone number at the office, we're on the Queens College campus, 328-324-4123.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And this month is t-shirt month, every Friday of the month. So we are wearing our autism t-shirts, which is another way that we've raised funds. Unfortunately, we didn't have our walk-a-thon, but
Oh, okay. So then we'll go to the website and support as best as we can. Marsha, thank you so much. I appreciate you.
And as always, you're a great support. Thank you.
Listen, and it's a big work that you were doing, and your sacrifice and your love for it. I know many, many persons would say that you guys are angels. And we're fortunate for those of us who may not need the service, but for those who do need the support, that we can think on our children and, you know, consider others who are going through this. And like you said, there are a lot of people who don't have the funds, man, who just don't have it.
No.
So thank you so much. You want to add something before you go?
Just that the government has been very supportive this year, and we're so good.
Awesome. Yeah. That's great.
Working together. Right.
Yeah.
Have a great day. Thanks again.
No problem. Thank you, Marsha. Marsha Newball there from Reach Autism, Reach Association. That's what I call it, Reach. Right. And she will be best to tell me what part of these words I mess up on a given day. So I got an interesting show for you guys. And again, if you have any, you want to support Reach, go to their website and donate if you want to give your time. However best we can, that's a big issue for a lot of parents that we don't talk about. But and thank God for organizations like Reach who are doing so well at being that undergirding, being that support that parents need desperately. So another news, COVID-19, the third wave, is real. It is here. It is not a figment of our imagination. It is one of those things where I've been saying for a while, listen, this is a serious issue. And this was a serious issue before it affected my family. This morning, I had to rush a loved one to the hospital because of COVID distress. Okay, I personally have to deal with this due to COVID distress. This is the second person in my life who is now in the hospital, admitted to the hospital. And it is very stressful. It is very heartbreaking. It is nothing like not being able to do anything but be there, and you can't, right? And these are people I love dearly. I said on this show, there are folks in my life who I know cannot afford to be infected with COVID-19. Comorbidities, just knowing how they would react. And sure enough, two people who I love dearly are struggling for air, right? So I don't want to hear this foolishness about, well, there's course correction. I don't want to hear this foolishness about, people die every day. Is it your person? Huh? Is it your person? This isn't a game. For months, from February, we've been having discussions on the show. I've been bringing on, and let me just say how grateful I am. How grateful I am. This job has afforded me to meet people who are on the front line, so I could call people. I can call people. And even having access to folks doesn't change how scary it is. It doesn't change that my loved ones are struggling for air. It doesn't change that ambulances are picking up people. It doesn't change that. It doesn't change that. It doesn't. It helps when you can call someone and say, how are they doing? And I know there are a lot of people who don't have that. One of my good friends, her grandmother was in the States in a nursing home. And when her grandmother passed away, all she could do was have the phone to her grandmother's ear. And, you know, say what she had to say to her. Grammy couldn't respond. When it's your person, this isn't fiction. When it's your person, it isn't an abstract idea. It isn't political. It's your person. You know, it's your person. So I haven't slept well in days. And it isn't getting easier. Reason why I'm even sharing this, though, is because I realize that we don't understand, maybe we don't get it, how much of a community spread this COVID-19 is. I've had people say some stupid things before. Oh, you know, everybody trying to scare you. Everybody, listen, y'all ain't scared because it ain't hit you. That's why you ain't scared. You ain't scared because you ain't got somebody you love who you're afraid that if they get it, you won't have them anymore. You ain't scared because this is not an issue for you. But you don't even know how it will affect you. These are people, look, and this is how I know it's community spread. I'm talking about people who barely go anywhere, but they do go to church. They do go to, the food store. But they're not going out. They're not doing the raves of 300 people. They're not going anywhere. But they can't tell you how they got it. I'm in quarantine now because we don't know. So, I mean, when it's your person, and I've been saying this before it became my people, y'all don't understand my people. My people, my loves, my loved ones, love to death. Don't know what I would do if they weren't here. My people. Okay? This is not a game. This is real. And we are in the midst of community spread. Hear me. It is now where it is everywhere. People are asymptomatic and are spreading it. Very upsetting to me. We're talking about the Speaker of the House of Assembly has to pull a stunt with our leadership to say there was just someone, the chief clerk was to work, trying to carry out the functions of government. The sick comes back to work only to have to go back home amongst people for almost a week. And the Speaker of the House of Assembly has to pull a stunt. I was told that the Prime Minister is now all up in his feelings because of the stunt that the Speaker had to pull to protect the people who work for him. What? What? Every time you see the Prime Minister, he's out with an entourage. We're door-to-door hunting. They know the numbers better than we do. They get the data. They ignore it. And then they're pushing this conversation of a silver bullet vaccine, but not telling us, is this vaccine working with the variant strain, which is seemingly based on other physicians who are on the front line, based on other persons within the field are saying, does this vaccine work with this variant? But now the Prime Minister's in his feelings because the Speaker has determined that he has to protect himself as a senior man. How many seniors are in the House of Assembly? Protect the journalists? Have to protect them? So simple that you need someone to protect you? But yet you won't fine people $90,000? Fine them. Enforce it. But when are you going to fine yourself? See, because when the Prime Minister gets sick or any member of Parliament gets sick, they're going to get special treatment. You don't have to worry about if the doctors and if the nurses know who's in the building. You don't have to worry about if your loved one has been left languishing outside on a porch, getting oxygen, sitting outside, crying in a chair for hours because no one came to see them. They don't have to worry about that. You don't get to worry that when they get sick, they could go away in the middle of a pandemic. Yeah? They don't have to worry about health insurance. They straight. But they won't confirm people so they could get a health insurance. But they're out here dollar mining, playing games with people's lives. Huh? Telling y'all, if I didn't know people, I can't tell you where my people would be right now. And that's sickening to me that I have to say that. It's sickening to me that over the past month, we've had over 1,000 positive cases. But they're campaigning. The speaker got to pull a stunt in the House of Assembly. Huh? Now it's at my doorstep. I got children. So what are we doing? And this is people who are trying, people who are staying away. I don't go to work. I've been doing my show from home since my child in order to protect. But everything's still open, right? We still open. We still open. We telling tourists, come. Once you vaccinated. Read an article. Gentleman in a 74-year-old, dosed twice, fully vaccinated, contracted COVID-19 and died in the States. Oh, this is a silver bullet? Y'all got to be freaking kidding me. What Wells could talk about a silver bullet? The only silver bullet is COVID. Huh? The only thing but going around here is ineptitude. I got doctors telling me, Nahaja, what is going on? They letting go of physicians. They ain't renewing the physicians. We losing nurses. We losing doctors. They ain't hiring. They sent a bunch of nurses out to give out this vaccine, but the hospitals are overrun. Campaigning. Prime Minister over one island right now talking about vaccines. Huh? You're putting commission together, breaking ground, trying to sell people on millions of dollars in giveaways and prizes and surprises when you can't even abide by your own COVID rules. But then tell other people how you live it, how they should live. Won't be judgmental. Look here, lead by example. From February, I've had physicians on this show sounding the alarm. Let me tell you how much I love Dr. Susan Williams Lockhart. Who, when I call her, she goes to tend to my relative. Got my relative on drip, huh? Medicine hanging in the house because the hospital let them go without a chest x-ray because they overrun. Now they're back in the hospital today. I got a relative who laid off. Look here, y'all don't understand. This is why I tell y'all, stop talking foolishness in my head. I saw one of the dumbest things in my life today. Y'all don't even understand how I realized in this country we combating a lot of stupid too. See, I could deal with the fact that you might have some issues with the conversation. But don't be dumb. Because dumbness can't win in a functioning country. We have to have all of our faculties. Don't let dumb people lead you down a dumb path. I saw a photo, some sort of photo sharing with someone wearing a blue shirt. And the blue shirt said that, you know, the cure for COVID has been around for ages. It's called your immune system. Oh, no. The cure for sickness is your immune system. Some level. Listen. Not the cure for COVID, because at least I could argue that's just dumb for COVID. When I saw it, you know what it made me think? You know how dumb that statement was? I have to get this. I have it. And CA could resend it to me so it could come to the top of my timeline. Right? So I when I saw it, what upset me with it all was that people now starting to talk this conspiracy crap. Like your immune system could save everything. Stop being idiots. Your immune system, if it could save everything, you would never be sick. Your immune system is built to do certain things, and there are new things that come in your immune system that your body ain't used to. Hence why we actually have medicine. Hence why your child wanted to be a doctor, but you couldn't afford it. Don't forget, call Bridget for scholarships. Huh? Are we serious? This is what we're doing now? 2021, this is what we're doing? We all hopping on the special train? No, I'm here for that. Nope. I got two people on oxygen right now. Two people. Okay? Had an ambulance, y'all. Don't even understand. And then, I'm unable to can. Now you're testing children. You're testing everybody. And this happened. Let me, and I'll give you why this is important. I'm sharing this with you. because folks don't even know what they have until it's too late, or we're ignoring the signs. One, always has sinus. All right. Always got tonsillitis and sinus, always dealing with this. So when they started to feel the flare-ups and when they started to have the draining in the sinuses and the headaches, they chalked it all up to what they were used to. Until one day, they went to the doctor. Hey, doc, my sinuses, my tonsils flare up, whatever. Doc gives them something for the tonsils. No COVID test, gives them something for the tonsils. Well, the tonsils ain't the issue. It's the inflammation. Huh? Now we coughing. I'm like, hold on, you don't sound right. What's going on with you? The other one apparently was having a cold for like the longest. But ain't let nobody know they can't shake this cold. But every time they get asked, are you okay? Another relative asks, you have to take a COVID test. You want, no, I ain't got COVID, I ain't got COVID. Y'all don't understand. I want y'all not to take this thing lightly. People, the exact same people, y'all hear me, that I've been saying, if I ever cannot afford to get sick and catch this thing, that would be them. I know what I talk in, man. And sure enough, now this is it. This is real. And it from April, 1,000 people with COVID. Y'all, and we acting like this ain't real. We're acting like this isn't a real thing. This is in the community. People are spreading it. You don't know who have it now. Put your mask back on. Sanitize. Lose your mind. Offend people. Huh? 6 feet. You're 90,000. That's it? Huh? We don't want lockdown now. Oh, no. We don't want lockdown now. I told y'all there would be triggers. When the hospital can't keep them, what are you going to do? Let people die out in a tent? Huh? I got family in the tent. A tent. I didn't even know how to convert the porch. Now this is part of my story. Yeah? This is part of my story. And this story, if y'all remember last year, my cousins lost their father to COVID last year. So they are triggered now because we are a close family. We love each other dearly. We are a close family. We don't play close. We close. Okay? So now everybody triggered. I can't keep my phone on. And I don't like answering my phone. This is real. Okay? And don't let anybody try to dissuade you. Go to the shop. Man, listen, go back to ordering in bulk. Go back to ordering in bulk if you can. Right? Go back to ordering in bulk. That's the crazy thing, y'all. I still order it in bulk. I don't go to the store like that except for bread, for eggs, things you need, which are the bed, what do they call it? The bread basket items. Huh? This always in my... I always got sanitizer spray. It don't matter. I had to buy a box of masks. Let me tell you how crazy this is. And for the record, listen, there's a reason why we aren't getting the real numbers. You cannot get the real numbers when a majority of Bahamians cannot afford the PCR test. Where you're getting the PCR test numbers, in my opinion, is when folks end up in places where they are sick, like the hospital, like the clinics, where they are giving you free PCR tests. What is going on is folks are getting the antigen tests, which I got. Okay? They're getting the cheaper version of it. If it's positive or if it's negative, that's definitive for people. I was told that a local shoe company, their boss, a local department store, boss was found positive with COVID. The store is closed and they all took this rapid antigen test. Ladies and gentlemen, rapid antigen test that as we have already concluded, is not the gold standard for the mere fact that you need to be symptomatic for it to give you a true accounting positive. If it's too early in the incubation period, you will be missed and deemed negative, and you will be free telling people that you are COVID negative to roam about the country, okay? But then by the time you get a symptom, it could be a headache, as benign as a headache. That's what it could be, just a headache. For people who suffer with migraines, like myself. Is that an indicator? Or is that COVID? If you didn't know that before, you ran your mind and your business walking around, huh? Hugging people. We don't know what's... Look, let me tell you. I have come to a place where I'm beyond frustrated that the speaker pulling a stunt, and I was told by qualified sources that Hubert Alexander Minnis is trying to figure out a way, based on the sources, how they could try and fix this, deal with this. Very upset with the speaker's tactic. Yeah? That's what we're upset about? Did we get the staff free testing yet? Huh? They need PCR tests. How many of your staff actually makes enough if you didn't confirm them? Huh? How many of your staff ain't making enough? How many of your staff have health insurance? Medical insurance to take care of some of these expenses. But y'all in the House of Assembly ain't get your check cut once. Huh? Y'all got health insurance still eating good off of the people's dime. If you know, Renwood Wells, know if he gets sick now, how many of the members of Parliament already gotten COVID, contracted COVID? None of them were scared. None was scared. And if they were afraid, they sure as heck had all of the resources and the tools to get it done, to help themselves. They didn't go through the same doors your mommy, your daddy, your uncle, your sister, your cousin. They ain't going through the same door. Okay? There was a national letter, and they went through the side door. They didn't have to sit on the porch. They ain't sitting in the waiting room for hours like your family will be if you don't take this crap seriously. They aren't doing that. You're doing that. All right? Children going to school, coming back positive, going to school, coming home positive. They are asymptomatic, but Grammy ain't. Huh? So what are we doing? There ain't no free testing. If you're showing symptoms, you can get a PCR test. At that point, is it too late? Yo, be mindful. Take everything seriously. If you can't afford to get the little... Once you're feeling any sort of symptoms, don't ask where you could have gotten it from. Let it go to God. Test. It is in the community. There is widespread community spread of COVID freaking 19. Don't come to me on my timeline talking about fear mongering. Y'all ridiculous. I ain't into it. Nope, not into it. You know why I ain't into it? Because y'all ain't afraid, because it ain't happened to you yet. No, I said this from the last year. This whole year I've been saying no one is expendable. I don't believe in expendability. I don't believe that a human life is not worth it. If you could save that one, save that one. Save it. Save that human. They have a family who loves them. They got kids or parents. We around here won't play games because of Russian roulette. You always play games, you know. You always play games. C.A. Nuri is with me, my good friend, joining me on the show. We'll also have Dr. Dwayne Sands joining us at 5 o'clock as well. CA, I took up a lot of your time, my boy. Welcome.
I'm just realizing that my camera is fuzzy.
We'll fix it on the break. How are you?
I'm doing well. I listened to what you were saying. I can feel your angst and your pain. And I am too concerned. I am concerned because it's definitely a third wave we're in. And this clearly is a different coronavirus than we were used to a year ago. This is more progressive, more aggressive, and it seems to be spreading quickly. And I think that more persons are infected than our peak time when we saw 60 persons per day,
yes.
70 persons per day. I believe that we are back in that 60 persons infected per day again. I believe that's the number that we are around right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, and it's, let me tell you, it's crazy. I know why your camera is fuzzy, because you have something in front of it, so it's focusing on that thing in the front there. So okay. We'll figure it out during the break. But see, when I tell you, this is one of those moments in time where I'm beyond frustrated, where I know you know what we have been saying on the show for months with concerns from February with regards to numbers, right? And now we are, this is within the community. You can't even tell, people can't even tell you now, Cecil, where they're contracting it from. That's what's got, you know, and this rapid antigen test thing, what it, if it's too early, you forget about the first exposure, thinking you might have gotten from somewhere else because you didn't test positive, right? So it's, we with that, like, this ain't making no sense to me. And the Speaker of the House having to pull a stunt whilst people are dying, not dying, well, sick and dying. We have how many people now? We've lost, what, four more people? Not this week, but during this month, we've lost people, right? There's no beds. Like, what are we doing? What are we doing? I don't know. What are we doing? Your thoughts? Sorry, I just stopped talking just now.
I understand. But, and there's a number of critique of the Speaker of the House, whether he's pulling theatrics, whether what his drama-filled day was needed. But I believe he's trying to bring awareness to how serious this matter is, that a person tests positive in his realm, in his office, and it seems that the government, who is promoting that we take it serious, is kind of lagging in terms of their response. And I am concerned about that. I am concerned about it. It was a serious charge that the speaker gave to the government, saying that they seemingly do not care about the health and welfare of his workers. And the government must respond. The government must respond and say exactly what are they doing in regards to that office. I know that I listened to a news report where Dr. Dwayne Sand said there's no need to clean, to have any deep cleaning for offices anymore. That science and that theory has been proven that it doesn't impact anything. So if you found that one person has COVID in your office, there's no need to deep clean. You can leave that and do the regular what time. But one must be concerned whether you were in close proximity to somebody, right?
Yeah.
For the past week, 2 weeks, you know, you're using the same telephone, you're using the same airspace, same air conditioned space, and whether that you were impacted, whether that you should quarantine, whether that you should go home and be concerned about your children and your wife and your own and your elderly and stuff like that. So that is the concern the speaker had, and there was no immediate response. And I am concerned about it. I am concerned about if clearly the government is not taking it serious, I shouldn't take it serious. So if somebody in my scope has COVID, then I should not be concerned and say, okay, let me go take one test, you know, just in case. Let me quarantine just in case. Because clearly the authority on it is showing by example what we should do.
Yeah, and we're going to have Dwayne on, and hopefully he's going to tell us exactly, you know, what should, you know, not what should be done. And for the record, one of the people who has helped me and my family through this time has been Dwayne Sands, right? I don't know if I could have gotten through this process without Dwayne. So Dwayne is quite familiar with the statistics that is my family. You know, Dr. Susan Williams Lockhart, quite familiar with what is going on with my family. I want to send special thanks and to Dr. Bassett, Melissa Ann Bassett. These are only because, Cecil, these are not only because, but I would think, I never knew them before my show. I never knew them before doing the show. and having them as guests or seeking them out for advice. Now I'm calling for favors. And I want people to get that. That is not normal. That is not normal. That is not how it should be. And for the people who are sitting, I mean, I got a loved one sitting there, and I tell them to take a photo. Let me see this porch space where they're at. This porch space. Let me see what, because they would tell me they're outside.
What do you mean by porch? Are they outside?
Outside. This is a space where they have converted. PMH had converted. That was a porch. They put some sort of thing over it. And so it's outside, right? It's outside. And I didn't know what that was. And I said, okay, look, let me, because I need to see this. Because when you say it outside, I'm thinking you outside in the elements. Well, kind of are. It's like a hallway outside, right? And they sent the photos. And in this hallway, a bunch of folks sitting with oxygen tanks in chairs. Just on oxygen. In chairs. And from 9:30 Tuesday morning until 2 a.m. Wednesday morning, they're not in a bed. See, so that's supposed to even mean knowing some people. Okay? Then there was the other issue, and thank God now, because I have already set things in motion. But after calling, when I knew I needed to call the ambulance because my doctor, Lockhart, was there to say, we have to take them now. Yeah? That's I thank God for Dr. Lockhart. I thank God for her. We have to take them now. You talk.
I don't know what to say. I'm, like I said, clearly you're emotional. I hear it in your voice. I am concerned for your well-being mentally, knowing that your loved one is in. See, it's one thing having COVID, but the next thing is having COVID in the hospital. Let's see, that's a different seriousness. Because, you know, more likely a lot of people have COVID. You always say, well, you're home with COVID. But when you're in a hospital, that means it's serious, right? Mm-hmm. And then the next step is ICU, you know? So I know that you are concerned. I know that you're concerned, especially you feeling helpless. And we've heard the story of loved ones dying alone. Loved ones cannot call and say, well, this is what happened to me. Cannot say their last word to say, well, family, I love you. Take care of your daddy, your sister, your brother, or what's not. So I understand that. I understand the fear. And but the human people need to understand how serious this is and how it's impacted the entire Bahamas. And when you're still seeing videos of concerts,
mm-hmm.
and not just regular concerts, you know, massive concerts. Nobody wearing masks. Nobody, because everybody drinking and eating. And
it ain't real. It's not real, you see.
And then you hear of persons with money saying only the staff is required to have the COVID vaccine.
Yeah.
And the patrons would come there and cough and
do whatever.
And drink up all the air and in that closed up environment, knowing that this is spreading. You know, we start questioning our sanity of whether we're taking this whole pandemic seriously. You know, are they as concerned as you are? You know, it seems as just any normal day that we are prepared. We are prepared to die. That's where we are.
They're prepared for somebody else to die. A lot of people ain't prepared to die. They're not prepared for their family to die. Everybody else could die because that's natural selection. Bunch of damn idiots. Let me play this clip because coming up at 5 o'clock, CA will be joining me. Dwayne Sands will be joining me. This is where we are in this pandemic. Oh, I should press play on it. That would be important. That would be pretty important.
Surging COVID-19 infections and increasing hospitalizations have placed the Bahamas in a dire situation. That's from former Health Minister Dr. Dwayne Sands, who says...
You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. We will be back after this. Dr. Dwayne Sands, C.A. Murray. We'll be back after this show.
Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. You're listening to the Guardian News Network. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's what's making news. Thank you for tuning in. Several relatives of Hurricane Dorian victims who are presumed dead after the storm testifying during the Hurricane Dorian inquest today. This as Her Majesty's coroner sought to dispel what she called myths about bodies that were stored in freezers and a trailer after the storm. Government has acquired the Grand Bahama International Airport, the sale concluded, and the final contract executed this afternoon with a purchase price of $1, plus roughly $1 million in staff-related costs. Tourism and Aviation Minister Dionisio de Aguilar said government would seek to enter into a public-private partnership to assist in the rebuilding, and government would spend about $1.5 million on repairs to improve the facility in the short term.
Once the ownership of the airport is transferred to the Airport Authority, a special purpose vehicle to operate and redevelop this airport will be set up, very similar to the construct at the Lyndon Pendling International Airport. In Nassau, the Airport Authority owns the Nassau Airport Development Company, or NAD, which redeveloped and now operates LPIA. Well, in Freeport, the Airport Authority will set up the Freeport Airport Development Company, or FAD, to redevelop and operate GDIA.
Business owners should encourage their employees to get the COVID-19 vaccine. That was one of the messages touted by the Prime Minister in Grand Bahama this afternoon, as he insisted it will help to keep businesses open and the economy afloat. Dr. Minnis said businesses with unvaccinated employees place the establishment's finances at risk, as they would be forced to temporarily close for sanitization.
And for those who are not, I encourage you to have them take a COVID test, PCR test, weekly, so as not to jeopardize the remainder of your employees.
And that's what's making news. I'm Taylor Ferguson. AP News is coming up next.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Coronavirus update. I'm Ed Donahue with an AP News Minute. A record high for the S&P 500. The Dow finished up 239 points. The nation's economic recovery from the pandemic is showing signs of momentum.
Americans are spending more, and so is the government. Two factors economists say are leading to a remarkably fast recovery. The economy last quarter grew at a brisk 6.4% annual rate, and the current quarter is expected to be even better. One economist says all the economy's engines are revving up. Jobless aid applications last week hit the lowest level since the pandemic began, and the housing market's strong heading into the summer. As more businesses reopen, Americans are increasingly shopping and eating out, and record-level federal spending's poised to flow into the economy. Sagar Magani, Washington.
Officials in New Orleans are again loosening restrictions, announcing restaurants, bars, and other businesses can soon operate at 100% capacity. I'm Ed Donahue.
All
Are you tired of that boring 9-to-5? Do you need a new and exciting career? Visit the Bahamas Technical and Vocational Institute, where your passion can become your profession. Let us introduce you to a career in information technology, cosmetology, construction, office administration, auto mechanics, electronics, and more. Say goodbye to that 9-to-5 and hello to the possibilities. Call us today at 502-6338. Apply by November 16, 2020.
Gran, it was good to see you, but we've got to get home.
Yep, we've got to let the dog out.
Speaking of dogs, you won't believe who I saw the other day.
Who?
Honey.
Remember Anton, Jeanette's oldest boy? The one with the dogs.
With local claims managers, we pay your motor claims fast. We're like a goodbye at your granny's that doesn't take 30 minutes.
We really got to get going.
So soon?
CG Atlantic Agents. Insurance, health, pensions, life. Good like that. That's on Insurance Brokers and Agents Limited trading as CG Atlantic Agents.
For the past 33 years, Great Commission Ministries has been defending the poor and hurting, feeding the hungry, and sheltering the homeless. We invite you to support our Live to Give program and make a difference in these challenging times. Become a donor by giving a one-time annual gift or a monthly donation of $50 or $100. Call Great Commission Ministries at 325-5801 for more details. Or visit our headquarters at 237 Wolf Road. Join Live to Give today. This public service announcement is proudly sponsored by this radio station.
When I had got prostate cancer, my family didn't know if I was going to live at Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number. They see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. That's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. We've got joining us today my good friend C.A. Nuri and, of course, my good doctor now, Dr. Dwayne Sands. How are you guys doing?
Good afternoon. Pretty well.
Good. It's good to have you on, Doc. C.A. Doc, I hear some echo. I don't know what's going on your side. Like, you're like super loud. I don't know what's going on now. Let me see if I can help you. All right. Was that better? Not really, but we'll work with it. All right. We got C.A. Nuri. We got Dwayne Tan. C.A., I don't know what's wrong with your camera. If you guys want to, you can follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/Nahaja Black Show, on YouTube, youtube.com/C/Nahaja Black. We are live. Subscribe. Join the Hitbacks following, please. We would love to have you. Well, Doc, it's good to have you on. You have been, with me for the past few days. You have been a great support in this past few days. I've told folks that I've got close family members that have now been stricken with COVID-19, and this morning having to rush someone to the hospital because of COVID-19. So my family is definitely in the thick of it, in the throes of this virus. I wanted to get from you. There's a lot to talk about here. So I'm going to let you dive in, Doc, because the question isn't about how serious it is. It's about how serious do other people believe it is. And that's what I want to get from you. Not just what do the Bahamian people believe, but what is government? Are your colleagues, is everybody on the same page with this being like real, legitimate?
I think this is a very important question, because certainly from the perspective of the clinicians, I'm speaking doctors, nurses, respiratory technicians, ambulance drivers, people that are involved in the care of patients with COVID, we are in trouble in the Bahamas. And the number of cases of people that are at home that have been exposed to documented, confirmed cases of COVID but haven't been tested themselves, that are at home with symptoms, short of breath. There are a number of those people. And so even as we watch the climb of cases, and the average number of cases exceeds 50 cases a day over the last 2 weeks, the month of April, we have had already 1,100 cases of COVID. And so by any definition, by positivity rate, by the number of deaths, we now have some 30-something deaths that are yet to be classified. And at the beginning of the month, I think that number was way, way less than that. By whatever metric you use, there's a problem. And you know, is that the message that is consistently going out? I'm not sure that that's the message that's consistently going out. Or if it is going out, it's not going out as firmly, as strongly as it needs to. And as a result, we see parties with 300 plus people resulting in a contribution of $100,000 into the public treasury. But what does $100,000 do if you could potentially have a super spreader event resulting in 1,000 plus cases? I think it's time for us to take a check of ourselves, to look at the experience in other places which thought that everything was good. Boy, we rolling, everything cool, and boom, the bottom falls out, and now you have one of the most populous countries in the world on its knees.
Let me get just tuning in, Dr. Dwayne Sands joining us. We are talking about COVID-19, this third wave. My good friend C.A. Murray joining us. I see C.A. had a quick question for you, so let me let him ask away.
C.A. It's always good to hear from you, Dr. Sands, and thank you very much for your opinion, coming to the public and giving your sound advice and your fears and concerns. I want to say thank you for that, first of all, because when you come on, I say, okay, let's see what Dr. Sands is saying. But I want to understand this, to you personally, on a scale of 1 to 10, how serious is this third wave in contrast to a year ago when we had our big numbers, our high numbers? I want to know, serving me up as in terms of how concerned should I be?
Without exaggeration, I think you should be very concerned. I would have looked at the ages of a cohort, a sampling of about 12 or 15 patients, and the mark that are hospitalized with COVID. The youngest was 25, some 30s, more than five, or at least five, less than 40. What does that say? That says that the story that we thought represented COVID, that this is a disease of old people, this is a disease of older, sicker people, and that young people don't get it, or they don't get sick from it, is rubbish. And maybe what we are seeing, and I don't believe that I'm breaking any new ground here, because Dr. Dowery just said it, and I believe that Dr. Forbes has said it, that we are probably seeing variants in the Bahamas now that may be either more transmissible or more aggressive. So, is the third wave likely to be as bad as the second? I think it is going to be worse than the second.
Okay, so with that said, then it brings, and that is That is what I've seen too, Doc, just from outside, right? Just from outside as an observer, listening to physicians. One of the things that was was very frustrating to me, Doc, was how long it took for that variant testing to be done. And I wondered many times, is this us dragging our feet? Because you don't want to. I mean, listen, Doc, I love you. I do show up with your body, but I love you, right? I would just keep it real. I do show up with the rest of them, but you, my guy, I can roll with you, you know? And funny thing is, because both of my people who you support me are members of Elizabeth, you might just get votes you wasn't getting before. I just throw that out there. What is going on now, Doc, is that Go ahead.
We got a problem that transcends any divisions among us, okay? And the message that you are trying to get out this afternoon is, people, wake up, okay? The train that's coming down the track is about to roll over us. Now, that is not to be alarmist. That is to say, let's take some stock and maybe we can head this off in the past, okay? But we need to be making sure that everybody wearing their masks, everybody got their mask on, that everybody's washing their hands. That party in the backyard, that's for you and your people in your circle. That ain't for the neighbor next door, or for the people around the street, or the gal or the fella that you haven't seen for a little while. Okay? We have a problem.
There's a great way here. I want to get to this question. I just got something and I want to post it. So give me 1 second. I want to share the screen here so I can show you this file. Just got this. I got this as an announcement. C.V. Bethel Senior High School wishes to advise the public that the school's annual baccalaureate service that was scheduled for April 29th at 6:30 p.m. has been postponed until further notice. The school also wishes to advise parents and guardians that as of April 29th, that's today, all classes will resume virtually until further notice. We sincerely apologize for any inconvenience caused. Doc, this is until further notice. I don't know if I've heard of any other schools say they're closed until further notice. Denise asks, says that I'm very concerned about our schools. Is this going to be the norm? Because I'm concerned. Private schools are doing the business. But are we taking too long with this? And let me unmute you to get that answer.
We don't know. I mean, we are right now in this very pregnant phase. What's going to happen? What's going to be delivered? It is the same kind of feeling that we had back in March of 2020, before we had that first case, wondering, is this going to come to our shores? If it does, what's going to happen? And so right now we're watching the numbers and hoping and praying that the numbers today will be 8 or 5 or 10. And then you're disappointed because it's 55 or 63 or whatever the number is. And then we had that horrible day when it was 115, albeit including cases that were being listed that had not been listed previously. So as it relates to the schools now, we don't know what's going to happen. And, you know, parents are wondering, boy, do I have to go back to this whole virtual thing again? Because, you know, I can't deal with that no more. And so we're all hoping that this is an aberration, but the numbers don't seem to support it. It's been 14 straight days of increasing. The trajectory is like this.
Peter Sarah's joining us on the Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Community spread. COVID-19, Dr. Dwayne Sands has said this is, he sees it to be worse than the second wave. All right, Dr. Ben, I have so many questions to ask you. And CA, if you have a question, you chime in right now if you can.
I'd like advice. Give me some advice as a layman. what I need to do, what I should be doing now during this turn where, you know, I'm concerned. So tell me what to do.
Yeah. I think one of the things that you ought to do is to take stock and ask yourself, am I serious about COVID, or am I suffering from COVID fatigue? Am I meticulous about my hand sanitization? Am I avoiding people that are not in my circle? Am I wearing my mask? And then you should ask yourself a serious question. What is it that's stopping me from getting vaccinated? Notwithstanding the numbers of vaccines that we have in country, which is a real issue, but certainly as of today, if you wanted to get a vaccine, you can get one. So why have you not gotten a vaccine? And then finally, in my corporate life, what am I doing to make sure that commerce can continue safely? Am I making sure that it's not about, you know, putting this thermometer on someone's skin and having them sanitize and then, you know, go for yourself? Because I think what we have done is we have convinced ourselves that all we need to do is, you know, have somebody stick a thermometer on you, wipe your hands, do like this, and then check it. You can do whatever you want after that.
Let me ask you this question then, Doc, because a lot of folks are saying that, and I know my timeline of reading, where their concern is when we talk about the vaccine, that video that you and I did, even though you've explained yourself that we were talking about the Pfizer Moderna vaccine, that's the RNA vaccine, and not the AstraZeneca vaccine, which I still don't believe that this is this magic bullet because of the variances. And then still there's a lot of data out there. I still don't believe that it is that magic, that silver bullet, Wendell Wells, them talking the banana cream and pie on, but that's your minister. A lot of people still believe that, Doc, you are one of the major catalysts. And I want you to do this again because it's not fair. When we were on the show together, we were indeed talking about the Pfizer and Moderna vaccine that was then being discussed. And the concern was, with you and I both looking at it as an mRNA vaccine. But folks are calling you a flip-flop on this, and that you were one of the catalysts or reasons why people ain't using the vaccine.
Okay, fine. I think what we probably have is a situation where people would like to be able to ascribe blame or point fingers in order to justify a fixed position that they already hold. And so understand that this thing is changing rapidly. 18 months ago, the world knew absolutely nothing about novel coronavirus or COVID-19. It didn't exist. We certainly never thought that it would have the impact on the world economy. We never thought that 150 million people would have been infected or confirmed to be infected. We never thought that 3.2 million people would die from it. We never thought that the economy of the world would crash the way it did. We never thought that the airline industry, the hotel industry, the cruise line industry would crash the way that it did. We never thought that in the Bahamas, some 30-40% of people would be underemployed or unemployed. And so it has evolved. And so our conversation today will be different tomorrow. It'll be different next week. It'll be different a month from now. And that is the reason why we've got to stay focused, stay informed, and engaged. So what we talk about today is appropriate for today. Next week, we are going to be having a whole different conversation. Hopefully, a conversation of how well the recovery is going, how well the Bahamas is doing, and not a conversation about panic.
Let me ask you, because I have so many things that I want to ask, and CIA, I know you have another question as well. In this space that we're in, and you talked about this, you know, the changing narrative, right? The changing narrative. We're hoping to be better off. We want to be better off in this situation with COVID-19. But the reality is, there's a lot of people walking around asymptomatic. I think there's a lot of people who are carrying the virus and don't know. until someone else in their family has it, or their symptoms are so mild. And I think that's the majority of Bahamians. They have more milder symptoms than maybe the extreme cases, or like my family who are now on oxygen. I don't know why I bring that up, because that stresses me out. But that we have this sort of, that's going on. From the medical side, Doc, please tell people, what are the signs? All of them now, because I'm learning you having diarrhea could be a sign. You thinking it might be conks, poisoning. It could be COVID.
So just not feeling well, having a fever, having a cough, having diarrhea, having vomiting, having a rash, having joint pains, finding out that your tongue is turning colors. All of these things are potential signs of COVID. A classical symptom is a loss of sense of smell or taste. We found that out early last year. All of a sudden you can't taste things and you can't smell anything. And that is a very, very diagnostic finding for COVID. So as we progress now, if you don't feel well, you have a headache, let's say, that's, you don't know where this headache came from. You may have a runny nose. Your eyes may be a little bit red. Trust me, any or all of those symptoms could be COVID, the only manifestation that you have. And so the bottom line is, if you don't feel well, one, stay home. Two, make an inquiry of your doctor or your healthcare practitioner to determine whether you ought to be tested, because it could very well be COVID.
Oh, no testers. No symptoms. Antoinette says she had no symptoms. None. Not one. Still have those symptoms. The only way, but she tested positive, and that's the story. Her husband was positive after he displayed symptoms, and she got tested with a PCR test, and, you know, now she's positive. Someone said, you know, excruciating back pain. Tested positive. Loss of appetite is one of those as well. People are, this is my timeline. People are saying they have tested positive. It is full on community spread. Are you open to saying that, Doc, that we are now past incidental? We are in full on community spread.
You know, let me say that to make that comment, I would need to look at the clusters, the case assessment, and public health is better equipped to do that. What I will say is that we have an unacceptably high level of COVID transmission and COVID cases, particularly in New Providence, secondarily in Grand Bahama, and a smattering of cases elsewhere. But certainly in New Providence, very few of the cases are imported. Very few of the cases are related to travel. And so either people are getting it in their homes, or they're getting it in their workplace, but they're getting it. And they're getting it at an alarming clip. Don't forget, from March until June or July 2020, we had only 106 cases, I think, in a few months, right? And then that second wave hit, and boom. We had on some days more than 100 cases. So as we now see 50, 55, 60 cases a day confirmed, and you're only testing 300, 400 persons a day, and your positivity rate is 10, 15, 20%, the likelihood is if you tested 1,000 people, you might find that you have twice the number that you thought you had. And so to only test at the level that we're testing, it is likely that we are missing a number of the cases.
Should testing be available?
That's a good question. I think it should be like every other health service. available for people who cannot afford it. Okay? So it should not be that if you're concerned and you need a COVID test, that you have to find the funds to pay for it. At the same time, I also understand that we have a very, very challenged health ministry that does not have an infinite bank book. And so you want to strike a balance because some people are getting COVID tests to travel. Some people are getting COVID tests to go into restaurants and so on and so forth. And if you can least afford it as a country, should they be free as well? That's where it starts to get into this. And so certainly some of them should be free. No question about it, as they are.
So if few cases are reported, where is the surge in new variants coming from? Where are they coming from?
They are coming from you and me going to a bar, taking our mask off, and sharing a nice raucous time with our friends, or interacting at home with our family members, when one of us has already been in that environment, or going into the workplace and sharing it. And even as I say this, I'm thinking about specific pieces that inform these comments. Somebody went to the barber, and the barber turns out to have been COVID positive. And then four, five, six. That particular incident, I think we had 14 cases that came out of that scenario. But you also have the scenario where people, when they don't feel well, still go to work. They still go to work. Okay? Because they're either afraid that they can get docked, or they're concerned that perhaps it isn't COVID, it's the cold, it's the flu, it's my sinus, or what have you.
We're going to take a break. See, I see your question, because I know where your questions are. I don't know, but I have a good idea, some of them as well. Let's take a quick break. When we come back, Dr. Dwayne Sands, see, when we get back, you lead off with your question for Dr. Dwayne Sands. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black, everyone. We will be back right after this.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you will also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to a Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
Imagine. That's where every advancement begins. With an idea that things can be different. Better. Now. Imagine a world where your entertainment experience was all about you, your style, your show, at your budget. At Rev, that's what we've imagined. To join the conversation and learn more about the future of Rev TV, visit us at rev.bs/imagine.
When I had got prostate cancer, my family didn't know if I was going to live at Cancer Treatment Centers of America. Within days, I got an appointment. They presented me with treatment options, and they set up a robotic prostatectomy. When my scans came back, there are no signs of cancer. They don't see you as a number, they see you as a part of family. I'm going on with my life. It's a real gift.
Call us at Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. I got my good friend. We're talking about COVID-19, the third wave. Like I said, my family is now a part of that statistic where we're very concerned. And I want to say special thanks again to all of the persons at PMH, to South Beach Clinic. Thank you so much for your help with them. We got my good friend, C.A. Nuri, as well as Dwayne. Where's Doc? I don't see Doc. Doc, are you there? Okay. Where did Doc go? I don't know. See ya. Can you hear me, Dwayne?
I'm here.
Oh, okay, good.
I'm in my car. I'm on my hands-free mute, okay? So, in case people are wondering. I don't want the police to lock me up, but I had to do a very important pickup.
Well,
6 o'clock.
Well, that's fine with us. We see we can get your volume up a bit because your volume went down a bit. But we'll have CA, your question. Unmute yourself, buddy.
Sorry about that. I said clearly we are lax. We have become lax regarding this COVID-19. Moving forward, I wanted to ask the good doctor, would he support additional restrictions or if the numbers continue to trend upward, and would he even support a lockdown in general in order to get these numbers back regulated or to numbers that we can deal with?
I think that I need only look at the recommendations of no less than the director of the Pan American Health Organization, Dr. Carissa Etienne, who just a day or two ago reminded member countries that that we have lost sight of the goal, and that we ought to all be considering tighter restrictions in order to bring this thing back under control, because the Americas is the site of the largest number of COVID cases in the world right now. So the area in which we live, the Pan-American area, has a disproportionate number of cases than any other region in the world. So to answer your question explicitly and specifically, I think let's give people a chance to get their act together. Let's give Bahamians and the Bahamas a chance to get their act together. And if not, then yes, I support much more draconian action, and I've said so publicly.
Getting our act back together, Dr. Sands. We're just tuning in, Dr. Dwayne Sands, on the Hit Back, C.A. Nuri, my co-host today. Getting our act back together, Doc, doesn't it start at the top, though? Where do you see, you know... you hit on this earlier, right? And when I asked, you know, are you guys, is the government taking it seriously enough, right? Doesn't it start where we don't have the Speaker of the House having to pull a stunt, which has been called a stunt, but very much people are in support of what he did? Doesn't it start where the chairs are socially distanced, where we have House of Assembly done virtually or new technical engagements? Doesn't it start at the top when we don't, regardless of the fact that you are declaring social distancing, but there's no way all them people are 6 feet apart on a campaign walkabout? Doesn't this start with leadership? This, you can't say one thing, but people see a different story.
You make a valid and reasonable point that if we are all going to be successful, we have to be singing from the same hymn sheet. So let us all get it right. And when we don't get it right, we should be called out for it. And so you should be prepared to take your beating, but you ought not to require a beating. Those of us in leadership ought to be setting the right example. And if we're not setting the right example, then we should be publicly chastised when we don't.
And just on that point alone, what did you think of what was done in the House of Assembly by the Speaker?
Well, as I said yesterday, I think that the Speaker, as the head of one of the co-equal branches of government, was exercising his autonomy. Now, the Constitution allows for it. We have a legislative branch, we have a executive branch, and we have a judiciary. The Prime Minister, the Speaker, and the Chief Justice are leaders or heads of each co-equal branch of government. And they have far-reaching powers in their space to do what they do. And so in his domain, in the legislature, the Speaker can do what, according to the rules, what he wants. And I'll leave it at that.
Someone asked a question. Do you support relaxing security measures at this time with regards to persons who have been vaccinated in country, as well as allowing persons to enter the country without testing, having only to rely on vaccine cards that may not be foolproof?
I think to answer the first question, that yes, liberalization of movements throughout the Bahamas for vaccinated persons, validated, verified vaccinated persons, is a bonus. It's a carrot, as it were, to encourage people to be vaccinated. And it would be believing in the science. In terms of people that are coming from outside of the country not tested, I have some challenges with that.
Well, let me ask you a question here, Doc. We know that the vaccine is, there's no data. Let me not say that. You let me know, because from what I've gathered, I haven't seen any data that sits or has confirmed through multiple, documents or documentation or processes, that the vaccine stops you from contracting COVID-19 and spreading it. It just stops us at this point from having severe outcomes, right? Is that the case or no?
Well, you continue to speak appropriately about, information that we're trying to put together. But when we're talking about moving around different parts of the island, no less a person than Levin Miller would have articulated quite well. If I want to go from Elizabeth to, let's say, Seabreeze, or from Seabreeze to South Beach or Golden Isles, I certainly don't get a COVID-19 test, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, every single island in the Bahamas is a part of the Bahamas. It's not a separate state. So it is a bit contrived that because we're talking about separation of land masses, that I need to do an RT-PCR at a great cost in order to move from island to island. And that has great repercussions in terms of people's ability to move back and forth. And quite frankly, that's not where the challenges lie. The challenges lie in New Providence and Nassau and Grand Bahama, sorry. So, if you can remove some of the impediment for inter-island transportation while maintaining hand sanitization and mask wearing, which is an effective way to reduce transmission, then why not?
Right. And where are we with data? There's another show that I'm planning on doing, Doc, with regards to where's the data on vaccinations so far? Where's the data on vaccinations, how people have been responding to the vaccine? Because I think we need to get to that space as well in this conversation. But I know CA has a question for you. CA? And unmute yourself, CA.
Before the doc goes, I know he mentioned earlier about how Bahamians are now galvanizing together and celebrating and taking off their masks. Would you support the, for lack of a better word, the closure of certain businesses that makes it more easily for the virus to spread, like a bar, like one or two restaurants, one or two clubs? Because we have the clubs open up again and they have events. Would you support the restriction of those places where those people take off their masks?
I think that we can legislate till we turn blue in the face. But unless we enforce and adhere to the legislation, it's all for naught. It's just some black ink written on some white paper. So we have an enforcement and a compliance problem. And so maybe the first step is to ramp up our enforcement to try and encourage compliance and use some more open, ongoing communication and education tools. Because you got to engage the public. You got to dialogue with the public. Talk to people in language they can understand. Don't pretty it up. Don't dumb it down. Don't carry it too high. Speak to people in language they can understand and make it come to life. Make it real.
Mm. Dwayne Sands, Doc, I'm thinking before I let you go, because I know you're about your business and you gave me more time than we'd originally agreed. CA, any final questions? I want to say this, Doc, before I let you go, as it stands now, what would you say, and I know you said it on a news clip, what's the state of the hospitals now, and what are we looking at when we're looking at persons that are admitted? What degree of sickness are we looking at?
The number of people in hospital, I think, and we'll wait for today's numbers, is around 50 across the archipelago, Grand Bahama, Nassau, but all of the facilities, South Beach, Samaritan's Purse Unit at Princess Margaret Hospital, the Legacy Unit at Doctors Hospital, Doctors West and Doctors East, all of them have COVID patients right now. And understand that we have lost nurses, we have lost respiratory technicians, we have lost physicians, we have lost nurses. And so we are trying to manage this increasing number with fewer human resources. And that don't fit very well. So I need people to get it in their head that this ain't no game. This is a very serious issue right now. And there are people showing up and being turned away because we're trying to manage the number of people in the hospital. And sometimes...
Sometimes those people come back and have to be readmitted, as I think you found out.
Yeah, no. I found that out personally. For folks, and this is the last thing I want to make sure we do this again, Doc, just so folks understand. Give folks possible symptoms, please, so that they know when to get tested.
Again, so fever, cough, headache, loss of sense.
Your phone ringing off the hook. Yeah, your phone ringing a little bit.
Sorry, it doesn't stop, unfortunately.
Oh, I know. And you'll answer my calls, too. Thank you.
So loss of sense of smell, loss of taste, bad feelings, runny nose, some red eyes. All of these things can sometimes be signs of COVID, and you really need to have people...
Are you there, Doc? Okay, so we may have lost Dr. Sands. I see him on the screen, but I know we might have lost his audio a bit. All right, CA, your thoughts. Unmute yourself, buddy. There you go.
I'm concerned, and this is sobering, and I appreciate you inviting Dr. Sands on the show to just air him out. And I know he's making rounds on media now and giving that caring call that something is wrong. We need to react and react quickly. But it's sobering to hear him speak and explain that this third wave is serious and that we need to be alert. We need to be defensive. We need to be aggressive in terms of approach. Because, you know, I have a sense of security. So, okay, we are over this now. You know, the vaccine is here. Things will get better. I see that the economy is opening up. I see the police no longer stop you on the road at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning. In fact, 10 o'clock, people are just coming out. When once upon a time, 10 o'clock was curfew time. People are just going out at the time. So to hear him speak so clear and to state that this is serious, it sobers me up. It sobers me up to step back and now to start analyzing my lifestyle. What have I been taking for granted? Do I need to start carrying my sanitizer everywhere instead of just having it in my car? Mm-hmm. Do I need to, when I drive in on the highway and the coconut man flag me down or the soda man flag me down and ask me if I want water, do I need to have my mask on in the car to say, no, boss, you're too close. You can't be talking to me.
And that's it, right? Like, what's the distance now? But this variant, and they're saying, oh, listen, it's far more contagious than the others, or what we had previously. Then it's 6 feet. Like, we better start measuring again.
Yeah. Do I need to go back to church or tell pastor we got to watch this on Zoom again? You know, these places are now a concern again. Whereas mm-hmm. I become comfortable and say, I go to church. I go to the funeral. You know, I'm going to the wedding. I'm going to sit down. You know, I'm going to take my mask off when we go to the reception and we're going to eat. Right. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure who's in at the table, who I'm eating with and sharing bread with. And now it's sobering me up that I need to be concerned. I need to decline and say, no, not today. I'm not going to this wedding. So send me some pictures. You know?
Yeah. And then we in our family are still trying to figure out how did they contract it? What happened? Right. And so it's very concerning when you don't know, but this is something we've been talking about for months. Right. And a question I was supposed to ask Doc that I didn't ask is, where did those 80 odd positive cases just magically show up from? Like, I mean, same thing. Where they had them sitting in which box? Like, did they go through government mail? Like, how did they miss that? How did they miss it, TA?
I'm concerned about the 80 and concerned about the numbers and the validity of the numbers. Is it more than 80? Is it less than 80? Are they keeping better count now? Did they do contract tracing on those 80? You know, how did that impact society in general? What was the mistake? Will the mistake happen again? You know, all of that is a concern, and I think it needs to be addressed, not just, oh, we just find it and we put it forward, that all of these numbers have, and cases have repercussions, and that these repercussions impact me. So I would like to know. It can't just flippantly dismiss my concerns and finding 80 cases of COVID positive people. It ain't no small number. That's 100 people. That's an extra 100 people out there walking about, you know, on the food store line. And I'm right next to me and saying, excuse me. I'm concerned about, they should be in quarantine. You know? I'm concerned about those people.
And listen, it's harder. It's going to be harder for even COVID task force. When we have more people infected, we don't have enough resources to ensure people are quarantined. You know what I mean? Somebody got to go to the store for them. Is the person who's going to the store for them, were they a part of the household? You know, again, these antigen tests are what folks are going to take because they're cheaper. They're going to take it. We must seriously consider. I had Dr. Sabriek Pinder-Butler on the show yesterday, and she said, look, government at least needs to figure out a way to subsidize the cost of PCR tests, because that is the gold standard test. Antigen tests, you need to be symptomatic. Otherwise, you're not going to get the results you need to get. But what, it's like a money-making, I'm sorry, man. I feel like this is a money-making racket, a lot of it, because you can't be serious. The thing that you call the gold standard, we can't come through some idea of how to subsidize it even. Because the only reason why we're getting PCRs at this point is persons who can afford it or persons who are sick. You know what I mean? And look, I can even tell y'all, there's a lot of crazy even in my family. Even in my family. Because after getting a positive test, someone say, I still ain't, that ain't real. Oh, Jesus Lord. Y'all don't understand. I like, ambulance coming for people, Cecil. Ambulance coming for people. And we around here, y'all are whining. I got the audacity to be upset with the speaker. I need a drink.
But definitely, we need to improve on our policing. I know the the COVID police have a mammoth task of policing New Providence, because every nook and cranny is having some kind of party. But clearly, if the government can and we have the resources, we need to hire more COVID police and have those COVID police patrolling the streets and issuing out fines to patrons. You know, I see we issue a fine to business owners. But if I'm a patron and I get shot $300 and I didn't expect to pay that, I'm not going to party no more. I can't afford those $300 to give government. So we need to now start policing, start writing some people up.
Oh, and I'm so glad you said that, start writing some people up. But we also, at the same time, CA, what we need to do is stop. I still can't get over the fact that we're talking about, oh, okay, staff, you're forced to get vaccinated so that my guests could be okay. So what? And then we allowing people to come in with vaccine. We have yet to prove that people with vaccines or vaccinated people cannot spread COVID-19. The Minister of Health in our country just called the vaccine a silver bullet. What? And they still haven't dealt with the trust issue that this administration has with the Bahamian people, with the competency. I mean, and so you're not showing by example. You're talking out your backside on a lot of things. We can't make money, making all kind of sense. You're doing ads in doctor's hospital where they ain't a caring on, but people sitting outside in PMH. We need to work on the testing. We need to know exactly what's going on. The variant test, the variant results took 3 months. 3 months, Cecil, 3 months. And they ain't telling people, we don't know what's going on yet. Physicians are telling you. Cecil, people were telling us on this show, Nahaja, I'm concerned. Nahaja, we know something's going on. There is a variant in country. This was in February. I've been talking to all kinds of people. Now that the stuff is no longer just an idea, no longer one or two, no longer one or two, because again, the antigen test results are not going into the big pile.
And as you mentioned a variant, I don't believe we have started a conversation on what this variant is and means to Bahamians. What does that mean regarding the vaccine? How do I interact with the variant? Which variant do we have? What is the symptoms of this variant? You know, the description and of what it means. I don't think we have had that discussion yet.
No.
You know,
you don't know what it is.
We need to go back to basics and start explaining to the Bahamian people what we are dealing with and what is the way forward. And I don't think that is happening yet. And don't forget, I want to mention this before we go. Just recently, we said that the authority said we're about to hit herd immunity. And I heard what you said before, but that is more crucial to talk about, that there is a narrative that the Bahamas soon hit herd immunity and be safe. And that discussion needs to be debunked or talked about some more.
Herd immunity. That's funny. How many people, for herd immunity to happen, we need, what, 85% at minimum? Okay. We're still begging we're begging now from the United States for vaccines. But at least the Minister of Health is doing that. At least he's smart enough to notice the trend. I wonder if that was the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to say, hey, did you watch the news? Because I don't think they'd really be paying attention. Or maybe Paho said something. But I was very impressed that they actually were smart enough to say we need to beg and get some vaccines in country. Still haven't figured out how they're going to get people to take the vaccines, other than supporting or not railing on physician, on business owners who are telling you to get the vaccine or get fired. But we digress. CA, thank you so much, my friend. I appreciate you. Dr. Dwayne Sands, I thank him so much again. Dr. Dwayne Sands, Dr. Susan Lockhart, Dr. Millicent Bassett, all of the wonderful people who I've had the opportunity to call who've been there for my family. And I wish that everybody had their number who's going through this. But everyone, please be safe. We are in a third wave and it's community spread. You are listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black, Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Everyone, take care of yourself. We're out.